the new part after finishing with the abdomen, that is the lower limb. And the lower limb will start with the, first of all, the front of thigh. As we know, any part we have to explore, we should know the arrangement of the bones in that region. So, in the front of the thigh, as this is the lower part of the abdomen, so where the lower abdomen ends, the lower limb starts. As we have finished with the lower limb, we know the bones of the abdomen, that is, this is the inguinal line or the inguinal crease, that is the end of the abdomen and start of the lower limb. And here we have already done in the abdomen, the lower part, the pelvis, the iliac crest, the anterior superior spine, anterior inferior iliac spine, then the iliopubic eminence, superior ramus of the pubis bone, this is the pubic symphysis, this is the ischiopubic ramus, this is the ischial tuberosity, this is the iliac pubic crest and this is the pubic tubercle, and this is the obturator line or obturator crest. And here lies the obturator foramen, and laterally here lies the acetabulum, the cup of the hip joint. So this is the, you have got the conception in your mind while starting with the lower limb, that how the hip bone is visible in the lower part of the abdomen, that is the pelvis. All the parameters you should know, what is pubic symphysis, pubic crest, pubic tubercle, pectineal line, obturator crest, pectin pubis, obturator foramen, iliopubic eminence, anterior inferior, all should be. And with this large acetabulum, there is fitted the head of the femur, which is a round, forming the hip joint. The upper end has got the head, then the neck is there immediately adjacent to it, then there is a greater tubercle laterally, which is outward a little bit and it is subcutaneous, we can feel it. Here, the greater tuberculum is just below the skin, as we can feel the anterior iliac spine, it is near the skin. Then, medially there is a lesser tuberculum, and anteriorly the greater tuberculum is attached to the lesser tuberculum continued by a very faint line that is called the intertrochanteric line. Then the shaft of the femur start with the medial border, this is the lateral border. So it is prism-like, three borders are there, medial, lateral and posterior. So medial border is continued downward and expanded medially into the medial condyle. The lateral border of the femur is continued laterally as a large part is called the lateral condyle. In between the two condyles, there is a smooth area for kneecap or the patella, which is having a large lateral and small medial part. We always make large L for L, large lateral and small medial. Just above the medial condyle, there is a small elevation of the bone that is called the adductor tubercle. So this is the element. So our thigh is straight, but the femur in it is obliquely placed. And then the lower end of the femur articulates with the upper end of the tibia, having the same name, the condyles, the medial condyle with the medial condyle, lateral condyle with the lateral condyle. And anteriorly, the upper end of the tibia, in the middle, BSA, elevation, this is called the tibial tuberosity. Then the tibia has got a medial border like femur and lateral border like the femur. and one is the anterior border. So it's a bit different from here, but it is also triangular, having three borders, medial, anterior, and post, and lateral. There is no posterior border. Then the lateral condyle of the tibia, it articulates with the another bone of the leg that is called the head of the fibula. And this is the fibula bone, like the upper limb we have done, two bones in the forearm, radius and ulna, same is here, tibia and fibula. Lateral is fibula, medial is the tibia. So this is the arrangement of the bones in the leg and the foot and the hip joint as well as the knee joint is the formation is there. Now as a dissection part of the front of the thigh, we are eager to know what lies behind the skin of our front of the thigh. So in the dissection part, first we will cut the skin, the first layer of the body. So we cut along the inguinal line, then we cut along the pubic symphysis, then a cut is made along the medial border of the skin of the thigh, and another we make the skin over the tibial tuberosity of the tibia, and then we reflect this skin laterally like this. After dissection, we remove it, and what we expect the second layer is superficial fascia. So here we see the superficial fascia, and what is the composition? Anywhere in the body, yellow color, fat. And number two, what we see here in this way, loose areolar tissue which held this fat, and then it contains cutaneous artery, veins, nerves, lymphatics, and lymph nodes. The same arrangement from head to toe. As skin is covering, so below the skin is the superficial fascia also. So when we remove the skin, we find the yellow color fat everywhere. If we see the yellow color fat, it means what we are seeing, that is the superficial fascia. So everywhere there is a yellow color fat is there, embedded there. And in this, we explore the structures, that is the cutaneous structures, which are visible in the embedded in the fat. So they are the number one is the nerves, cutaneous nerve. So cutaneous means skin, so they are sensory. So they will supply the skin. So in the nerve we see the laterally, a nerve is seen. We supply the lateral surface of the skin of the thigh, coming from the abdomen and supplying it. This is the lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh. Lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh we see here, supplying the lateral part of the skin. Then we see here the medial part of the skin of the thigh is also supplied by a cutaneous nerve. This is called medial cutaneous nerve of the thigh. Medial cutaneous nerve of the thigh. Then a third nerve is seen in between the lateral and medial. So this is called the intermediate cutaneous nerve of the thigh. That is called the intermediate cutaneous nerve of the thigh. So three nerves we encounter, skin supplying, as we remove the skin, so these are broken down and we can't see them. So they are just below the skin, medial, lateral and intermediate branch. Lateral cutaneous nerve of the thigh, having root value L1. The medial cutaneous nerve of the thigh is the branch of the obturator nerve. The intermediate cutaneous nerve branch is the branch of the femoral nerve. So they are the sensory branches of the lumbar plexus, or the supplying there the brachial plexus in the upper limb. So all the muscles in the lower limb they are supplied by the lumbar plexus. And lumbar plexus is formed by the union of L1, L2, L3, L4 and L5. All they are contributed here. Then in this, we also see the arteries also. So arteries are visible, they are superficial arteries. So they are seen from the, in the upper part, a artery thread-like is supplies the lower part of the abdomen going from the lower limb. Another artery will supply the medial part of the thigh upper part and supply the external genitalia. Another artery cell thread-like goes towards the anterior iliac spine and supply the area there. So these superficial branches we encounter the arteries cutaneous. Names of these arteries they are the external genitalia is called the superficial external pudendal artery supplying the external genitalia. There is a penis in the male and the vagina in the female. Superficial external pudendal. Then there is also superficial inferior epigastric artery, as the name suggests. Epigastric artery, it supplies the lower part of the skin of the abdomen, this much area below the umbilicus. Third, which goes towards the anterior spinal spine, is called the superficial circumflex iliac artery, because it is going towards the iliac spine. So they are the names of the arteries that are telling which area they are supplying over them. Then the same name of the cutaneous veins are also accompanying them. So wherever the artery goes, the veins start and it brings the impure blood back. So accompanying the veins are also present, having the same name. All are superficial because they are lying just below the skin. So they are all named. Then comes the fourth thing, which is the lymph nodes and lymphatics. So lymphatics, they are the cleanser of the body, they are the sweepers of the body. So the lymph nodes, they are present along the inguinal line in a form of chain, and they are all interconnected. And lymphatics, they start as the blind tubes and they come in the lower part of the abdomen below the umbilicus. So all these lymphatics, they connected to the superficial inguinal group of the lymph nodes, because they are lying along the inguinal line or the crease of the body. So they are called the superficial inguinal lymph nodes. Superficial inguinal lymph nodes. And they have a T-shape arrangement. Alphabet T, so it has got a horizontal part and a vertical part. The horizontal part is parallel to the inguinal line or the inguinal ligament. The vertical part lies along a very prominent vein, which is present in the medial part of the thigh, which is a superficial vein, but it is a very thick vein. So some lymph nodes, the vertical group lies along this large vein that is called the great saphenous vein. Great saphenous vein is visible along the vertical medial part of the thigh, and a few lymph nodes, they are also present along this vein, and they are all interconnected, and all the vertical as well as the horizontal group of the lymphatics, they are all interconnected. And the lymphatics from the lateral part of the thigh and the medial part of the thigh, they are all terminate into the vertical group of the lymph nodes. So there is a plenty of the lymph nodes are present along the front of the medial part of the thigh, having the T-shape arrangement, a horizontal group and a vertical group. So this must be explored in the front of the thigh. We have just removed the skin of the front of it. So these structures we encounter. Then when we remove all these structures, but we preserve the great saphenous vein. We remove all the structures except the great saphenous vein. Then third part, when we remove, what we expect? Deep fascia. So deep fascia of the front of the thigh is visible, and deep fascia of the front of the thigh is called the fascia lata. Its name is fascia lata, is the name given to the deep fascia of the, is the name of the scientist who discovered this there is called the fascia lata is the front of the thigh. And this deep fascia has the function, it consists of the thick bundles of the collagen fibers, and the deep fascia protects the deeper structures. What deeper structures? The muscles, the artery, veins, nerves, and the bones also. So it is shock absorber, and that is the, plus it also gives the shape to the thigh also. The shape of the thigh, broad above and tapers downward, is given by the fascia lata as the function of the fascia, deep fascia, anywhere in the body. And this fascia is very much important because of its attachment. So it is having this circumferential arrangement. Circumferential attachment to the bony points of the pelvis. Circumferential means it is go all around the upper part of it. And it stick to the lower part, becomes narrow, as it is called the gloves and stocking type. This is the gloves and stocking type of the deep fascia, as in the winters, these stockings are made by the females. So exactly where the stockings, the upper end of the stocking touches, same is the attachment of the deep fascia. So where it is attached? Number one, we start from the pubic symphysis. Then from the pubic symphysis, it is attached to the, comes down and attached to the ischiopubic ramus. From the ischiopubic ramus, it is attached to the ischial tuberosity. The next bony point, ischial tuberosity. Then from ischial tuberosity, it goes to the posterior inferior iliac spine. But before it going to the posterior inferior spine, it is attached to a ligament which is called the sacrotuberous ligament. Sacrotuberous ligament, as the name suggests. Sacrotuberous means it is attached from the sacrum to the tuberous, means ischial tuberosity. Then it is attached to the posterior inferior iliac spine of the hip bone. So like the anterior iliac spine, there is also posterior, inferior and posterior, superior iliac spine posteriorly. And sacrotuberous ligament is attached from the sacrum and then to the ischial tuberosity, the medial part. Then from the posterior inferior iliac spine is attached to the posterior superior iliac spine. From here, then it attaches to the outer border of the iliac crest. And from the outer border of the iliac crest, then it comes to the anterior inferior iliac spine. So this is the sequential, you should do the steps. Posterior superior iliac spine. Then seventh position is the outer lip of iliac crest, it is attached, then it is attached to the anterior superior iliac spine. And from the anterior iliac spine, as we know, a ligament is attached from here. From the abdomen, we have seen that this ligament is then medially attached in the pubic tubercle. So this is the inguinal and not attached to the crest. Only attached to the inguinal ligament. Then next, it is attached to the entire length of the inguinal ligament. The next attachment is the inguinal ligament. Then from the inguinal ligament, the next attachment is to the pubic tubercle. From pubic tubercle, then it is attached to the pubic crest. And pubic crest, next part is the point is the pubic symphysis. So we have started with the pubic symphysis. So it is come to the pubic symphysis. So it is called the circumferential attachment. So you should know all the bony points, pubic tubercle, and from pubic tubercle to the 11th point is the pubic crest. From pubic crest, it reaches the pubic symphysis. So we have started from that pubic symphysis, it reaches the pubic symphysis. That's why it is called the circumferential attachment. Now, it has got the lateral extension also. Laterally, when it is attached to the outer lip of the iliac crest, it is attached to the pubic tubercle. And pubic tubercle is the point on the outer lip of the iliac crest. Here, the deep fascia in the lower part goes to the tibia. So from the iliac tubercle laterally, this deep fascia is thickened laterally, part of the thigh, and below it is attached to the lateral condyle of the tibia. So this is the thickening of the deep fascia, of the fascia lata, superior to the pubic tubercle, the iliac tubercle, and below to the lateral condyle of the tibia. So it is thick everywhere, but here laterally it becomes 3 and 4 times thicker. And this thicker part is called the iliotibial tract. Iliotibial tract. As ilio means iliac tubercle, tibial means lateral condyle of the tibia. So it is, and when we trace it superiorly, it becomes bifid. It is Y-shaped, as it is attached to the outer, the pubic tubercle. It becomes Y-shaped. And in this Y of this, there is a muscle is attached here, which is taken from the pubic tubercle and inserted on the deep fascia here, iliotibial tract. This muscle is called the tensor fascia lata. This muscle is called tensor fascia lata. As the name suggests, when this muscle contracts, then the whole of the iliotibial tract becomes tight, and that is the function. And the necessity of this tensor fascia lata is that it is a shock absorber. So there are, when a person is standing, there are more chances that the patient may fall, person may fall laterally. The front, the back of the fall is very, very rare. Most of the time, accidentally, person falls on the lateral side. So when a person falls on the lateral side, then this muscle contracts and it makes the lateral part of the fascia lata tight, and when it strikes against the ground, the lateral part of the thigh, the femur is not fractured. So that's why it's called the shock absorber. Second function is, it gives the insertion of a very large muscles of the hip or the gluteal region, the gluteus maximus. We'll do later on. So it gives a very much large insertion of a muscle of the back of the hip. So that is the two functions of the iliotibial tract. Then, this is all about the fascia lata. Another thing of the fascia lata is that in the upper medial part, around the termination of the great saphenous vein, here there is an oval gap is there in the fascia lata. Deep fascia is absent here in the upper medial part of the thigh. And an oval shape opening is present in the deep fascia, and it lies 4 cm below and lateral to the pubic tubercle. 4 cm below and lateral to the pubic tubercle. So this is called the saphenous opening. This gap in the deep fascia is called the saphenous opening. Saphenous opening. So this saphenous opening is a weak point in the front of the medial part of the thigh. It may lead to the hernia that is called the saphenous hernia. Otherwise, deep fascia is present everywhere and front of the thigh is very, very strong. But this is a weak point because of the opening. This opening is present to facilitate the great saphenous vein, which has to open into a deep vein. So that's why this is absent. Its lateral part is higher and the medial part is lower in position of this oval opening, saphenous opening. Lateral part is higher and medial part is indistinct or not well defined, but lateral part is very much defined. Then another thing about the deep fascia is that we have already done that there is a Scarpa's fascia was there, if you remember, in the lower part of the abdomen, we start midway between the umbilicus and pubic symphysis, somewhere here. Another fascia is present, membranous layer of the superior fascia of the abdomen. As we have done the perineum, in the perineum it goes to the gall fascia pulis. The same membranous layer of the Scarpa's fascia, it comes crossing the inguinal ligament and it comes into the front of the thigh. So it is not confined to the inguinal line, but it crosses it and comes down 8 cm below and parallel to the inguinal line or the crease we have done. 8 cm below and it. And where it is attached then? Then it is attached to the fascia lata or the deep fascia of the front of the thigh. So this Scarpa's fascia extension into the perineum is called the Cooley's fascia. Its extension into the front of the thigh is called the Holden's line. So along the Holden's line, it is attached to the fascia lata. How many centimeters? 8 centimeters below and parallel. So why 8 centimeters? Why not less than? Because it has to cover the saphenous opus, which is only present 4-5 centimeters below the inguinal line. So in order to prevent the saphenous hernia, that's why this is the reason why the membranous layer has crossed the inguinal crease and entered into the front of the thigh, to minimize the chances of saphenous hernia. Even then, the saphenous hernia occurs because membranous layer is very, very thin. It can't prevent the puckering of the hernia. So the part of this membranous layer of the Scarpa's fascia covering over the saphenous opening is perforated by many arteries and the veins. So that the part of the Scarpa's fascia covering the saphenous opening is having the holes, the largest hole is made by the great saphenous vein, because it has to open into a deep vein, that is the femoral vein. So that is the rule, all superficial veins they have to open into deep veins, and deep veins they lie below the deep fascia. That's why the saphenous opening has been created. And all the cutaneous veins we have seen and arteries we have seen, the superficial external pudendal, superficial inferior epigastric artery and the veins, all these veins and arteries, they perforate this cribriform fascia. So 6 arteries and 6 veins, cutaneous, they perforate the cribriform fascia because they are the branches of the deeply lying femoral artery and femoral vein. They have to terminate. So 6 holes made by the 6 cutaneous superficial branches. One big hole is made by the great saphenous vein. So when we only visualize the saphenous opening and holes made by base artery and veins, so it looks like the sieve-like structure. And because of the sieve-like or the having many perforations or the holes in it, so this small piece of the Scarpa's fascia covering the saphenous opening where the deep fascia is absent is named as the cribriform fascia. Cribriform fascia. The cribriform, what we have already done in the skull, the anterior cranial fossa, cribriform plate of the ethmoid bone. Why it was called cribriform? Because it was having multiple holes on the foramen to facilitate the olfactory nerves to terminate into olfactory bulb, that the first cranial nerve. So second word, we are using the cribriform in the thigh also. So you should remember what is cribriform fascia and why the holes are present over there. So this is the about the deep fascia of this. Now, so whenever there is a hernia is there, the Holden's line, we have seen the upright anatomy, the Holden lies into the extravasation of the urine. The urine cannot go beyond the Holden's line. It can having the swelling over the lower abdomen and the upper part of the thigh above the Holden line, but never before that. Another applied anatomy of this is the saphenous hernia. So saphenous hernia is also the coming from the abdominal contents are coming. So in the lower part of the abdomen, if there is a thinness is there in the old age or in the obesity or in the female with the multiple pregnancies, so they are prone to the hernia, and the people who are engaged in the prolonged standing hours of their working place, they are prone to the, with the gravity, they are prone to the hernia. Like the inguinal hernia we have done, the same causes are also applicable to the saphenous hernia. So whenever the hernia comes, it comes downward, forward, and then upward. Because when the swelling is there in the saphenous opening, it cannot go below this, because there is another deface is very tightly attached. So this is the direction of the hernia which is coming from the abdomen, the downward, forward, and then upward. So upward swelling goes from the saphenous opening, because saphenous opening is very tightly adherent medially and the inferior part, but very little is higher in position. So the direction of the hernia goes like this. It cannot go medially, it cannot go below. It only goes to the lower medial part, that is upward, that's why the direction of the saphenous hernia. So this is all about the deep fascia. After the deep fascia we have done, we remove it, see all its attachments, and we remember them. The next part after removing the deep fascia, what we expect is the muscles of the thigh. Here the muscles of the thighs are also visible, and the muscles of the thigh, they are arranged in the three groups. In the front of thigh, one is called the medial group. Second is called the intermediate group, and third is called the lateral group. So we will take one by one while the muscles are there. So whenever the muscle comes, five fingers comes in front. That is the origin, insertion, external supply, and applied. The same is applicable whenever a question comes about the writer note on any muscles of the thigh, same is the arrangement. So muscles of the medial group, the names of these muscles, they are gracilis, the name of this muscle, then adductor longus, then adductor brevis, then adductor magnus. So these are the muscles of the medial group of them. So we will take one by one. First is the gracilis. Gracilis is the medial most muscle of the thigh. Gracilis. Now we will take the origin of this muscle. So this muscle takes origin from the body of the pubis, just near the, what is called the, parallel to the pubic symphysis. So this is the, how we show by a vertical small line is the origin of the gracilis over there. So that is the origin of the gracilis muscle. So if we see here the pubic tubercle, so the pubic symphysis, ischiopubic ramus, ischiodubrosti, the pubic crest, pubic tubercle, obturator crest, obturator foramen, this is the pectin pubis, the pectineal line, iliopubic eminence, and this is the anterior iliac spine, anterior superior iliac spine. So these are the bony parameters. So the gracilis muscle takes in from the medial part of the front of the body of the pubis, parallel to the pubic symphysis. As it is the medial most of this muscle of the thigh, it goes medially downward, and it is inserted over the upper medial part of the shaft of the tibia. Upper medial part of the shaft of the tibia is the insertion of the medial most muscle of the thigh, that is the gracilis. So origin, insertion. So what will be the action? So whenever this muscle will contract, hip bone won't move. What will move? Tibia. In which direction? That is called the action. So it will bring about the flexion at the knee. It will keep the tibia upward. So when the tibia is up, so that is called the flexion at the knee joint, is the action of the gracilis. Second muscle is the adductor longus. So adductor longus muscle takes origin from the, again from the body of the pubis, front of the body of the pubis, just an angle between the pubic symphysis and pubic crest. So this is the how you show the origin of the pubic, that is the adductor longus. A very small bindi like bindi you put on the ladies, so just a spot is there, so that is how you mark the origin of the, what is called the adductor longus, small, just angle between the pubic crest and pubic symphysis here, highest point. And from here, this muscle goes downward and a little bit laterally, and it is inserted over the posterior border of the femur. Inserted over the posterior border of the femur. So from here it goes downward and becomes fan shape, and inserted over the posterior border of the femur. So that is the adductor longus. This is the adductor longus. The medial border of the adductor longus is the lateral border of the adductor longus. It goes back side. And this obturator foramen is closed by a membrane that is called the obturator membrane. All of this hole is closed except superolaterally. Superolaterally there is a hole is there in the obturator foramen. Otherwise whole of the obturator, this foramen is closed by a obturator membrane. Inside there is a muscle obturator internus, outside it gives the origin of the obturator externus. But it is not present superolaterally, there is a gap. And this gap is called the obturator canal. This is the obturator canal is the name. Then comes the second muscle, third muscle, that is the adductor brevis. So as the name suggests, it is brief or smaller than the longus. So this muscle takes origin from the, again from the body of the pubis. In front, on the lateral part, and from here, this muscle goes laterally in front of the longus muscle, and is also inserted over the posterior border of the femur. Posterior border of the femur, adductor brevis. It is small, so long is bigger. This is brief, so it is small, that is called the adductor brevis. But it lies in front of the longus. Then third muscle is the adductor magnus. So name is, first word is telling the action of the muscle. It brings about the adduction of the thigh. So as you are sitting with the cross leg, so your leg which is above the another thigh is the adductor. So this is the adduction. So adductor magnus means it is magnified. Larger is the origin and larger is the insertion, that's why we named this muscle as the adductor magnus. Magnificent, magnified, bigger. So this muscle takes origin from a very big area. So this was the adductor brevis. A line in front of the body of pubis, but later. Then adductor magnus, it takes origin from the lateral border of the body of the pubis. Number two, ischiopubic ramus. Number three, ischial dubrosti. So this large line shows the origin of the adductor magnus, the magnified or the big muscle out of all adductors. So from this big origin, this muscle lies posterior most, and this muscle is also, from its large origin, the upper border is also inserted over the linea aspera or the posterior. Posterior border of the femur is also called linea aspera. So uppermost fibers of the adductor magnus, they are there. lower fibers, they reach up to the pubic ischial tuberosity. This is the ischial tuberosity. So the lowermost fibers, then they go downward up to the pubic adductor tubercle. So adductor tubercle give the lowermost fibers of the insertion. It's called adductor tubercle because adductor magnus is inserted over here. So this is a fan-shaped muscle, the upper border, the medial border and lateral border. Another important thing about the adductor magnus is it has got the five openings at the insertion. Five aponeurotic. So its insertion is also aponeurotic. What is aponeurotic? When the muscle becomes sheet-like, paper-like, thin, like we have done external oblique and all muscles. So adductor magnus is insertion is, origin is fleshy or thick, but the insertion is aponeurotic on the linea aspera or the posterior border of the femur bone. So the largest opening in its insertion is lies just above the adductor tubercle. And this large opening is named as the hiatus magnus. Hiatus means opening, magnus means in the muscle. Adductor magnus. So hiatus magnus is the largest opening in it. All other four openings, they are present on the posterior border of the linea aspera. So we'll do later on when we do the post back of the thigh. So upper four openings are smaller, but this is the largest opening. Fifth, the adductor magnus, the hiatus magnus. So this is how we do the adductor magnus muscle. Now another thing about the adductor magnus is that adductor magnus doesn't terminate or end at the adductor tubercle. But from the adductor tubercle, a aponeurotic extension of this muscle, goes downward and medially and gets attached to the medial surface of the medial condyle of the tibia. It crosses the knee joint and then the aponeurotic extension from the muscle from the adductor tubercle downward goes towards the and becomes broad also and attached to the medial condyle of the medial surface. And this extension from adductor tubercle to the medial condyle is called the tibial collateral ligament. This is the knee joint ligament, tibial collateral ligament. So this ligament gives the outside support to the knee joint. Extension is there. So this is how the large muscle, the adductor magnus, we have to do. Then comes the next, the intermediate group of the muscle. The intermediate group of the muscle, the names of these muscles, they are number one, pectineus. Number two is the psoas major. Third is iliacus. And fourth is sartorius. So four muscles we have done in the medial part, intermediate also four and lateral also four. So four, four and four. So 12 muscles are present in the front of the thigh. So first is the pectineus. As the name suggests, pectineus. So this muscle will take origin from the pectin pubis. So this is the triangular area called the pectin pubis between the pectineal line and obturator line. So this muscle gives origin from this triangular area, the pectin pubis. And this muscle runs obliquely laterally in front of the obturator foramen and it is attached to the upper medial part 5 cm. Upper 5 cm of the medial part of the shaft of the femur. Insertion of the pectineus muscle. So it is almost quadrilateral muscle. Pectineus is the name because of its origin from pectin pubis and insertion. So origin insertion, so what will be the action? So whenever this will get dead, it also bring about the adduction. Then the psoas major, as we have done in the abdominal, the same abdomen, the psoas major taking only from the T12, L1, L2, L3, L4 vertebra. And this muscle, we have done in the posterior abdominal wall with the thoracolumbar fascia. Then this psoas major muscle will come below the inguinal ligament. A tendon comes downward which is inserted over the posterior surface of the lesser, this is the lesser trochanter, posterior surface insertion. So tendon becomes narrow. So ask major muscle. So when you use contraction, what will it bring about? Thigh will move up. This is called the flexion. So pectineus is also doing the adduction as well as the flexion also. So this is the flexion. So when we move like this, this is the flexion at the hip joint done by the psoas major. Then the iliacus. So iliacus muscle will take from the whole of this iliac fossa. So whole of this iliac fossa will give a large muscle of origin that is called the iliacus muscle. So iliacus muscle takes origin from the iliac fossa, large area. Then this muscle also passes below the bridge between the lower limb and abdomen, that is the inguinal ligament. So below is the tendon of the iliacus comes. It joins with the psoas major tendon. And both are inserted on the same posterior surface of the lesser trochanter. So at the insertion, so both the tendons of the muscle, they become very, very close. So that's why sometimes it's called the iliopsoas. So this is the iliacus muscle. So again the origin, insertion, so action is again flexion at the hip. It also moves the femur upward. So that is also the flexion. Iliacus. Then the sartorius. Sartorius is the largest skeletal muscles of the human body. Sartorius. It is also called Taylor's muscle. So this muscle takes it from anterior superior iliac spine. So anterior superior iliac spine gives the origin of the sartorius muscle, plus it also gives the attachment to the inguinal ligament also. So one ligament, one muscle you have to remember. Then this sartorius muscle goes downward and medially, and it is also inserted with the gracilis. Insertion of the sartorius is inverted hockey shape and insertion is aponeurotic. So this is how we make the insertion of the sartorius in the upper medial part of the shaft of the tibia. Upper medial part of the shaft of the tibia is the insertion of the inverted hockey shape. Then gracilis is lying. This is the insertion of gracilis. This is the sartorius, this is the inverted hockey shape, aponeurotic. So that is the sartorius muscle. So coming from lateral side, crossing whole of the length of the thigh and then inserting on the tibia. So this is the long muscle. So action of this muscle is because it is crossing two joints. First is the hip joint, another it is crossing the knee joint. So there will be two actions. So one action at the hip joint will be the flexion at the hip. It brings the upward. And at the knee joint, tibia also moves upwards, so it also brings the flexion at the knee joint. So it is the flexor of both the hip joint as well as knee joint. You remember about the sartorius muscle. The last group is the lateral group. Again, lateral group of the muscle, they are four in number. Four in number. So names of the muscle they are called quadriceps femoris. Quadriceps femoris muscle. Quadri means four. It is formed by the union of four parts of the muscle. One of the large, strongest muscle of the body. Quadriceps femoris. Parts of the muscle, they are the rectus femoris. Then vastus medialis. Then vastus intermedialis. Then vastus lateralis. All four unite to form a single muscle that is called quadriceps femoris. Again, lateral having the four muscles. So we go one by one. Vastus lateralis as means it takes origin from the linea sprawl, the posterior border of the femur. And from posterior border it comes in the front, covering the lateral surface of the shaft of the femur. This is vastus lateralis. And the vastus medialis, as the name, it comes from the medial surface of the shaft of the femur, medial surface, and it also wraps the femur and comes in the front. Plus, it also takes it from the intertrochanteric line also. So that is the vastus medialis. Then vastus intermedialis. So vastus intermedialis takes origin from the whole of the shaft of the front of the femur. So this whole muscle origin is the, how we show the origin of the vastus intermedialis. So vastus medialis come from the linea aspera, vastus lateralis and medialis both unite with the vastus intermedialis. So three muscles, they are united here. So that is the vastus intermedialis and this. Then the last four muscles is the rectus femoris. As the name rectus femoris means, it is rectus means it is straight. So rectus femoris muscle takes on from number one from the anterior inferior iliac spine. And this muscle, another head of the this muscle also takes origin from the, that is called the oblique part. This oblique part of this muscle takes origin from the acetabulum. And both the parts, the rectus femoris come straightway downward, vertically, and they are, it get fused with already fused three muscles. So all four muscles they form now is called the quadriceps femoris. And a very strong tendon of the quadriceps femoris is going downward for insertion. So this all four fused tendons of the quadriceps femoris is inserted over the tibial tuberosity. So tibial tuberosity is the insertion of the quadriceps femoris muscle. As during the flexion and extension, the posterior surface of the tendon of the quadriceps femoris has got friction with the front of the femur and the tibia. So this tendon will be cut. So in order to prevent the damage to the posterior surface of the tendon of the quadriceps femoris, a bone is formed inside the tendon. Bone is formed inside the tendon. This bone is called patella, or what is called the kneecap. So patella bone is formed inside the tendon to prevent the damage to the tendon of the quadriceps femoris. And this triangular bone inside the tendon is called the patella or the kneecap. It is a sesamoid bone. Sesamoid bone. So sesamoid word we have taken from the botany. So two type of the plants are there in the universe, angiosperms and gymnosperms. What is the difference? Angiosperms, they are covered. And gymnosperms, they are naked, like the fern and the pteridophytes. So it is like the angiosperm, seed-like, sesamoid word, the word sesamoid means seed-like, underline it. Sesamoid word means seed-like, as seeds are hidden in the legumes of the pea or angiosperms. So it is not visible unless or until we will cut the tendon and we will see inside bone is lying over. So number one difference of the any bone of the body and the sesamoid bone is, number one, it develops in the tendon of the muscle. Number two, it has got no periosteum. Otherwise, all the bones in the human body, they are covered outside by a periosteum covering. But there is no periosteum over the sesamoid bone. Third, it has no medullary cavity. If you break it, it is solid from inside. It's not hollow. Except the clavicle bone is also, we have done, it is also having no medullary cavity. Sesamoid bone is having no medullary. So that is how anybody asks you what is the difference between sesamoid bone and so there are other small sesamoid bones are also present in the foot, we will see later on. So this is the largest sesamoid bone in the body. That is called the patella. Then from the apex of the patella downward towards the end of the muscle. So this whole of the tendon is made up of, no muscle fibers are visible here. Only muscle fibers are only present up to the in front of the patella. All vastus lateralis and vastus medialis and intermedialis, they are all inserted over the anterior surface of the patella. But from the apex of the patella to the tibial tuberosity, there is only thick bundles of the tendon of the quadriceps femoris, that is called the collagen fibers. And it is avascular, it is having no muscle fibers. And this part of the tendon of the quadriceps femur is called the ligamentum patelli. This is called the ligamentum patelli. Ligamentum patelli. Actually, it is a misnomer. It is not a ligament of the patella. Actually, it is the tendon of the quadriceps femoris. But because of the absence of the muscle fibers beyond the apex of the patella, it looks like the ligament of the patella. That's what we call the ligamentum patelli. So this is how we do the muscles of the front of the thigh. Then comes the position, insertion, the action. So what will be the action of this muscle? When the muscle will contract, the femur, where the tibia will move upward. And what is this movement at the knee joint? Is the extension. So it is the extensor. So lateral muscle is the extensor, intermediate group is the flexor, and the medial group is adductor in action. It is also called adductor group, flexor group, and extensor group of the front of the thigh. Regarding the nerve supply, immediately this obturator canal is called obturator canal. Why? Because through this obturator nerve comes from the lumbar plexus. And it passes behind the pubic, the adductor brevis, and it supplies the adductor brevis and adductor longus. Plus, it also supplies the gracilis. So, three muscles supplied by the obturator nerve, anterior trunk. It has got two branches. Anterior branch supplies the three muscles. Then the posterior branch. The posterior branch, it pierces the obturator externus muscle. Obturator external muscle taken from obturator membrane outer surface. Obturator externus. And the posterior branch will pierce the obturator externus and then it comes backward and it supplies the adductor magnus, which is a large muscle. So posterior division or posterior branch of obturator nerve supplies the large muscle, the adductor magnus. Plus the obturator nerve also supply the medial half of the pectineus muscle also. So pectineus muscle medial half is supplied by the branch of obturator nerve. Plus the obturator nerve also gives the articular branch in the acetabulum. It supplies the hip joint also, because hip joint is very very near to this. So this is the obturator canal is somewhere here. So from obturator canal, it will go into the acetabulum and supply the hip joint. So this is very near to this. So this is how the obturator nerve, the root value of the obturator nerve is L3, L2, L3 and L4. L2, L3 and L4, but ventral or anterior ramus. Ventral or anterior ramus is the obturator nerve. It supplies the muscle. Then it also gives a cutaneous branch. It gives the medial cutaneous nerve of thigh, we have done in the superficial field. So medial cutaneous nerve of the thigh is the branch of the obturator nerve. Then comes the another muscles. All other muscles, they are supplied by one nerve that is called the femoral nerve. So femoral nerve is also the branch having the same root value L2, L3, L4, but from the dorsal or the posterior ramus. And this nerve enters from the lateral border of the psoas major muscle. The obturator nerve comes from the medial part of the medial border of the psoas major. While from the lateral part of the psoas major, femoral nerve comes and passes below the abdominal inguinal ligament and enters the thigh in the lateral part. And it also divided into two branches, anterior and posterior divisions, like the obturator nerve. The anterior division supplies the sartorius, longest muscle of the body. Then it gives a branch, cutaneous branch, that is called saphenous nerve. Saphenous nerve is the longest cutaneous nerve of the body. Saphenous nerve. And this saphenous nerve, it runs over the medial part of the thigh comes on the medial part of the knee joint. Here it is accompanied by the saphenous artery, it is accompanied by the great saphenous vein, and from here the saphenous nerve goes on the medial part of the leg over the tibia, and from here it terminates to the medial part of the dorsum of the foot. It reaches. See the length. Whole of the lower limb is covered by the saphenous nerve, the cutaneous branch. So that is the branch of the femoral nerve. Then this anterior division also supplies the medial lateral half of the pectineus muscle. So pectineus muscle enjoys the nerve supply of the two nerves, medially obturated nerve and lateral half is by the femoral nerve. That's why it's called the hybrid muscle. Such a muscle is called hybrid muscle, or the muscle with the dual nerve supply. In the upper limb, we have done another muscle like this. Which was the muscle? Name of the muscle having two nerve supply? Brachialis. Medial half of brachialis supplied by the musculocutaneous, and lateral half was supplied by the radial nerve, if you remember. Brachialis muscle in the upper limb is also hybrid muscle example. Then the posterior division of this saphenous nerve, this femoral nerve, it supplies the all quadriceps femoris, four parts: the vastus medialis, vastus lateralis, vastus intermedialis, and rectus femoris. All four parts of the quadriceps femoris is supplied by the posterior division of the femoral nerve. Along with the, it also gives a cutaneous branch. The name of the cutaneous branch of the posterior division is called the intermediate cutaneous nerve of the thigh. Intermediate cutaneous nerve of the thigh. So that's why we do the all the muscles of the four, the front of the thigh, along with their nerve supply, their action also. So next part we will do the next part.